Everybody, welcome to another installment of Should Have Been with Mike G, the show of life, the show of Vermont's arts, art schools, being a hippie Guatemala, and so much more with today's guest, Ivy Mix of Leyenda in New York City. It's a great chat with her about a lot of different things, mostly about art, art school, love, being open to culture, being open to people. But of course, we talk about the project from Mr. Steven Soderbergh, Singani 63, an amazing Bolivian brandy. Get to sip some of that. Get to talk about mezcal. Get to talk about the traveling life of Ivy Mix. It is a brilliant chat, and I'm so glad she made it into Austin to sit down and chat with me. So without further ado, I hope you guys enjoy this great chat with Leyenda's Ivy Mix.
Know in the beginning of the book, you talked to the girl who killed herself in the bathroom.
Yes,
the girl from War Paint, actually.
Yeah, yes. So that's the dorm that I was placed in my freshman year.
So, oh my gosh. So yeah. What year, so was it after the movie came out then? So it has like
yes,
this ominous after,
yeah,
tone.
Yeah.
Was there like kind of little tours that went into that bathroom? You're like, that's where it was filmed.
Well, once we all kind of like caught wind, we're like, holy shit, Swan. Oh God. And then we all knew like which, he mentioned the room that she lived in.
Oh my
we were
gosh,
all
that's
like,
crazy.
Oh my God.
That scene, like, have you seen Rules of Attraction?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't like it when I first saw it, but love it now.
Yeah.
Even James Vanderbeek. I really grew to appreciate James Vanderbeek. But that scene is so dark.
Oh, totally.
But beautiful, because they've got that fucking song going on.
Yeah.
The, time, the Harry Nilsson.
Yeah, I actually revisit that movie. It's been a long time since I've seen it. I feel like Rules of Attraction and Romeo and Juliet are kind of like in the same, great soundtracks.
Dude, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, okay, so this all stems... It feels like, and I did a bit of research about kind of the stuff that you've done, the stuff you're doing with Leyenda, now with the brandy,
yeah,
which is fucking incredible stuff.
Yeah.
Singani. And I think this all starts from art, though, right? Your parents are both artists.
Mm-hmm.
What was their medium? What kinds of things did they work with?
Sure. So I grew up in central Vermont,
in
the middle of nowhere, like a town of 750 people.
Holy crap.
Yeah. I have an identical twin sister. My mom had us when she was 40. We were a complete accident. She wanted one boy, and she's going to name him John, and then, oops, got us, you know?
Twofold.
Twofold and, like, wrong sex. But now, of course, you know, we're great. My mom's my best friend. But,
yeah.
My father and my mom met in central Vermont, where we're from. My mom had just moved there. My dad had moved there as a child and kind of was glass-blowing. He's a glass-blower.
Oh,
he
cool.
had gone to Hampshire College the first year. It was an accredited school.
Uh-huh.
And just like everyone else from Hampshire, he promptly dropped out because he discovered glass blowing, and he moved to Sweden and also Copenhagen and Venice.
Wow.
And lived in Europe for a while and learned how to blow glass and moved back to Vermont because it was cheap and he could open up a furnace, and he's converted an old barn into a glass studio.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And I met my mom, who was 9 years older than him, and my mom at the time was working as a social worker.
For the state, for the community, or?
For the community. I can't quite remember what she was doing, but just like social work.
Yeah.
And then she's the oldest of, well, my dad's a sibling of a five-person family. My mom's also from a five-person family.
Really?
My mom's family's from Illinois. My dad's family's from Minnesota. But my mom was the oldest of five children Chicago, outside Chicago.
Yeah.
And she always, still does, has a knack for like getting stains out of things. She's just like a
stains,
like just totally in the.
I get this thing.
She's,
actually,
you know, I mean, I shit you not, she can get the stain out of anything.
Really?
She's got this crazy skill. So, around when she met my dad, she started going to different antique places in Vermont because there's a ton of just like it's more like secondhand stores, and she really liked fabric and art. She was really inspired by Buckminster Fuller and like. Got into architecture and design, and she started going to these shops and finding like really raggedy stained old lace and like really nice textiles, getting all the stains out of it and then reselling it for a huge profit.
That's brilliant.
Yeah.
It's like renovating a car, renovating a house,
totally.
Right?
Yeah. And she kind of took like the, I mean, my mom's nowhere even close to a housewife. She's like a super feminist, but she kind of took those skills that she learned from her mother in 1950s Illinois and turned them into this skill. And through it, she started vending these nice pieces of lace and linen and stuff at shows.
Wow.
Met this other Italian woman, and she's like, we should go into business together. So they started going to Italy and importing Italian linens, and now she has a really large textile company.
That's incredible.
Yeah, so it's
pretty great. Such a weird pivot into it, right? Like, well, I'm helping out the community, and now I'm helping out people with this other kind of aspect.
It's awesome. And she started the whole thing at 40. Like, she had twins and started her business at 40 years old.
That's brilliant.
So there's hope for all of us.
There's I have 3 years left to accomplish something.
Exactly.
I'm not getting any taller.
Yeah.
I'm getting grayer.
Yeah, right.
Something has to come of all of this. So it feels like this nice balance of, gosh, you have this almost like construction base, like using your hands.
Yeah.
But then also this creative element that is this nice amalgam for you between your parents, right? And so if other things that I kind of saw is that you had... Is it safe to call it a duality, maybe, that you had this underlying creative nature, but yet you're very athletic? Because sometimes those are in conflict.
Yeah,
you know?
For sure. I mean, you know, growing up in central Vermont, there's nothing to do. So you have to kind of find your things to do. And my parents are both, like, they're artists, but my dad, he's really more of a craft person than anything. Like, he considers what he does a craft art, not necessarily a fine art.
I see. Okay. Maybe functional?
Functional form, but you know, it's like you're not gonna take one of his vases that costs $2,000 and like put a pansy in there. You know what I'm saying? Usually just sits on the shelf and it's
It holds stuff. But I'd like to sit and admire it a little bit.
Exactly.
That's very humble of him, though.
He's super. I mean, his stuff is unbelievable. But growing up with not a lot of stuff to do, my sister and I were immediately put into athletic stuff. Mm. Like growing up, a huge part of my life that I don't get to do that much anymore, but pretty much the only other job I've ever had was training horses.
Really?
So as a little girl, my sister, my mom was like, she worked all the time. She started this business, and my dad also had his glass blowing thing. So in lieu of childcare or what have you, they put us into horseback riding, which kind of bit them in the ass at the end of the day because it's an incredibly expensive hobby.
That's amazing. Did you guys ever come home and say, you know, it'd be nice, mom and dad, why don't we get a horse?
Well, that's exactly what happened.
Yeah,
exactly. So my sister had a horse. I had a horse. She kind of grew out of it, everyone else. Like, she wasn't a little girl anymore, so she was like, I'm kind of over this shit. But I never did, and I really thought I was going to spend my whole life training horses.
That's
but then
amazing.
I went to college, and I got into art myself, and then sold my horse, and but...
Was it... I heard that you like dogs, and that you'll pet every dog across the street, right? Which
yeah, it's true.
Do you, I guess I try to look for other commonalities in people I talk to because I really love animals.
Mm.
It comes from my mom. She had a horse ranch and stuff when
really?
She was, in New Mexico.
Oh, amazing.
And she loves horses. There's something really magical about them. So for you, did you feel a connection to these horses, to animals, to nature? All of them?
Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, maybe we can get like all psychological about it. You know, having a twin sister, we're identical twins, and there was always people being like, we were never like, I wasn't Ivy and she wasn't Tess. It was more like we were the twins, especially in a town of 750 people. It's like,
it's easier that way.
This is like, they're the girls,
time,
you know, here they go, off they go. And, you know, she rode her horse and I rode my horse. And it was really this individualized thing.
Yeah.
We had a connection with another creature. I mean, when I sold my horse, it was probably the hardest thing I've ever had to do.
Yeah.
It was horrible.
That's what I hear. It's like selling a kid.
Oh, totally.
I'm not even exaggerating.
It was horrible, and it's because I ended up moving to Latin America that I had to sell him. My mom was like, I'm not going to pay boarding for this horse. Like, it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
So I sold him, and, you know, Bally, wherever you are, if you hear this.
What kind of horse?
He was a Connemara Thoroughbred Cross.
What color are those typically?
Connemara is an Irish breed. They're kind of tiny ponies, but they can really jump.
Yeah.
And he was a bay, a dark bay. So he was basically black.
Oh, man.
Really, really so dark brown that he was basically black.
It's amazing.
He was the best. But yeah, I definitely have a connection with animals. Like you were saying earlier, like, I may never have kids, but I always have a dog. Like, I'm definitely the same way.
Why does that conversation keep coming up? This is like the second time today. Like, but I really like, I look at my dog and I feel this fondness that I have never felt towards any kids.
No, and I'm totally the same way. Like, my mom has my dog right now, and I'm like, keep on texting. I'm like, how's Samson?
You know? Oh, man.
Good.
What kind of dog?
He's a mutt. Ah. He's from West Virginia somewhere.
Saving the mutts, man.
Yeah.
That's seriously one of the best things that we can do.
Yeah.
So the college piece, it feels like your folks did some college stuff. So was that kind of always the path for you? Like, you're going to get out of this small town of 700 or so people and you got to go.
Yeah. So I grew up a Waldorf student. Like, my sister and I went to Waldorf school from like preschool all the way up until seventh grade. And then we went to a public high school. But it was always kind of, my parents say now, they're like, yeah, we kind of let you have a cultural education rather than a real education.
Interesting.
Because the public high school where I was from was like...
Trashy?
Trashy. I had a retention rate of 50%.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
Yeah.
I'm glad you're not pregnant.
Yeah, well, right? Me too. You and me both, because I, you know, I don't like kids.
Yeah, that, geez, that's a double-edged sword.
Not nearly as cute as that dog. yeah, so I, so they always want us to go to college. It's so funny, because on paper, I seemed like not a great, I seemed like a real unique applicant, because I went to a high school that had less, that had a 50% retention rate.
Yeah.
I had a father that never graduated from college and dropped out. I had a mom that took 9 years to graduate college. So they were all like, you know, I came from, they were like, apart from being like a black girl from the projects in like Atlanta, I was like a hot ticket. You know, I was like this unusual. I didn't go to a boarding school in Connecticut or anything like that. Just, so when I applied to college, it really super helped me out.
Yeah.
So I ended up going to Bennington in southern Vermont. I decided not to leave the state at first because I had a crazy ex-boyfriend in high school. So he was like, no, you can't go anywhere. So I went to Bennington.
Were you guys still dating when you got out of high school?
Still dating when I got out of high school. Still dating. I took a year off in between high school and college. Still doing that whole time. Got to college. And 1 month later, I was like, fine, I'm free. And I broke up with him. And crazy, crazy motherfucker. But that's, I mean,
I think we've both maybe dipped our feet in that kind of experience.
Oh, right, yeah.
Do you ever think of, like, now we're getting older, because everybody is. Every now and again, I think about that particular girl who punched me, because I'm a very nonviolent person. Mm-hmm. Do you ever just, like, every once in a while say, I'm so fucking glad I got out.
Oh, God.
I'm so glad I'm doing this and this.
Oh, yeah. All the time. All the time. I mean he was a seriously bad person. But I'm really glad that I went to Bennington. I applied to all these colleges. There, you know, I applied to the usual liberal arts suspects. I have, like, Bard, Bennington. I applied to, I think, one in the West Coast, but I can't remember where. Got into all of them because I was this, like, unique.
You're the motley crew of talents and experience.
Well, I don't think that was it. I think they were like, oh my God, her dad didn't graduate college and she has a retention, the high school doesn't have a retention rate. Like, I was this anomaly on paper.
Were they, okay, so let me try to understand. Were they trying to, like, she's a good project?
Yes, I think I was a good project. I was a good project. They viewed me as diversity.
Got it.
I wasn't like the every other kid that applies to liberal arts schools that, like, you know, went to boarding school since they were two.
Got
and,
it.
You know, was the, you know, it was just different.
Yeah, an outcast almost.
Kind of, yeah. And when I went to Bennington, and when I got there, it was just like this, it was a really amazing experience being able to be at that college. It's a weird one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Bennington's a weird school. It's, they focus, I was there in kind of a weird time. I kind of was there before it got super straight. They went through a time there with the president of the college who was just trying to lace it up and make it like a social science school. And
Well,
I'm an artist. And, like, abstract expressionism started here. And, like, so did modern dance.
It did?
Yeah.
So this is the stuff I'm learning. I realized in 1932 they converted it from a women's college.
Yeah, exactly.
And so it starts out in that way. So did it, by the time you were there, did it still have those firm, what I'd consider feminist roots there?
Oh, God. I mean, it's like 70% women at Bennington.
Amazing.
It's a 500-person campus, maybe 600.
Really?
Yeah, it's very small. And of the 30% of that are men, like 20% of them are gay. So it's like definitely like,
it is a really easy place to be as a woman, then, I'd imagine.
It's a real great place to be a man.
All right, glass half full, half empty, depending how you look at it.
Yeah, like all the Bennington girls joke that when they graduate and they go out into the real world, like everyone moved to Brooklyn and they're like, oh my God, you want me? Oh God, really? No kidding. Because we were like basically nuns in college, you know?
Oh my gosh, that's amazing. But you would think that it's almost counter what I would expect. Because it's like so much creativity, so much people finding themselves, right?
Totally. I mean, Bennington is a really amazing place. And you know, it's a total unusual school. You have your fall term and your spring term, like every other college. But we also have a winter term where it's called field work term, in which you do work in your field. And as a freshman, I didn't have a field. I also had this crazy ex-boyfriend. And yeah. I was like, Mom, I want to leave the fucking country. Like, I don't want to be here.
Just leave it in the rearview mirror.
Yeah. And I was like, you know, get me the fuck out. Like, I want to go. Because yeah. also, I'm from central Vermont. I'm going to college in a 500-person college in southern Vermont. You know, I hadn't really experienced the world.
Yeah. It feels like you're just, there are varying levels of breaking free.
Yes.
But not truly breaking out of that small town,
yeah.
small thing.
So in my first fieldwork term, I went to Guatemala, and that's actually how I started bartending.
Cafe No Se worked up a massive bill, apparently.
Yeah, exactly. So
what were you drinking to accrue such a bill?
Well, I go to Guatemala, and I thought that I was going, I was 19,
yeah.
and I was super green, you know, like very naive, and I thought I was going to go to the woods and be the only gringa and like... You know, I have this like soul searching. I was a total hippie in college. Like, I really thought I was gonna like find myself. Like, yeah. I go up to this like colonial town and it's bustling, and I was like, oh,
what?
And there's all these getting. There's like tons. The Antigua is used as like a tourist as a hub.
Yeah.
Because Guatemala City, especially at the time, was very dangerous. So people would fly into Guate, drive 45 minutes to Antigua, and then take buses to go everywhere else in Guatemala.
Gotcha. So everybody thinks this is the greatest place in Central America.
Yeah.
And then it gets a little grittier.
Oh, totally. But yeah, so I'm there, and I was kind of like, oh my God, this place is like a lot more interesting than I thought it was going to be. And I was pretty not good at like conversing and talking to people. I was
really?
Like, well, you know, my first boyfriend was a complete asshole.
Yeah.
And I was just like.
They always are.
Yeah. And I was just like, so I was there, and I'm like, oh, do I go to a bar and like talk to people? Do I go to a cafe? There was no Facebook. No one had a cell phone.
Yeah.
It was in 2004. Like, people had cell phones, but no one traveled with them. So it was like everyone went to internet cafes. I ended up going into this bar because I heard Bob Dylan playing, and that was my first concert.
Was it really?
Mm-hmm.
How old were you when you saw Bob Dylan?
I was 8.
That's incredible.
Bob Dylan and Van Morrison.
All right. Now we're absolutely going to get back on track with Antigua. But you talk about hippie nature.
Mm-hmm.
I'll fill in the fashion stuff in my head.
Right? Yeah.
But musically, what kinds of things were you really into at that time that were inspiring?
When I was younger?
Yeah, like in college.
Oh, God, in college. I've always been, I think because I come from central Vermont, like everyone's like, you know, when you're younger and you're like, what kind of music do you like? And I was like, anything but country. And I was like, I like country. And not like your top 40 country, you know, like Mott B, a little dust on the bottle or anything like that.
My dog stole my whiskey. For my wife, or what are you writing?
Exactly, like get on the tractor and hoody ho, whatever it is. But I've always liked, like, if I could make, to me, my favorite type of music is like rainy day, kind of country folky, like Gillian Welch. I'm a huge fan of Gillian Welch.
Yeah, yeah.
I was then, I still am now.
What about Bob Dylan's good? What about Nick Drake, for example, or Elliot Smith?
Oh my God, in college, I loved Nick Drake. Oh my God, Five Leaves, or what was it called? What's that album called?
I can't remember.
And I listened to it nonstop.
But that kind of stuff.
Yeah, kind of like
heavy.
Did
you feel a lot? Were you?
I'm a big feeler. I've got all the feels. I mean, that's like part of my. I wouldn't say it's part of my problem.
Yeah. But, you got to. You know what? I think music's a good way to invoke
as I've,
that.
Yeah, as I've gotten older, I've learned how to rein it in. One of my friends in Guatemala, actually, John, he owns Cafe No Se. He's the one who hired me. He's one of my best friends on the planet, and I just really love him, but we got into this fight in Guatemala once where he was like, you know what your fucking problem is? You just wear your heart in your sleeve too much. You gotta fix that shit. You know, I was 19 and he was 40 something, and I was
like, of course he would, you know, he's been through some shit at 40.
No, exactly. But I was just like, you know, I'm 19, I'm living in Guatemala, and I have this new it was a crazy experience. And yeah, I racked up a bill that high because I just went there every day and you were allowed to have tabs.
Yeah.
And I was young and, you know, yeah, it was an amazing experience. I miss it a lot. And it
seems like incredibly formal. Like, if you're going to pick a place to go and sit down, make it in Guatemala and make it at Cafe No Se. And I don't even know if the mezcal piece was there in place yet in 2004.
It was, but that wasn't like, it's like, yeah, we're a mezcal bar. And I was like, what the fuck is that?
Yeah.
You know? And I really pretty much started drinking it because that's what everyone drank. Like, I didn't know anything. I was 19. I was like, whatever. Yeah, sure.
Great to be a blank slate like that.
Totally.
You can't do that going to New York now, right?
No,
coming to Austin, it's we're in a way we're tattered in a little. Maybe not jaded, but tattered.
Tattered. I think that's correct. Yeah. And I ended up traveling throughout Oaxaca. It was amazing. Like that when I think back to it, I'm like, yeah, I was 19, 20 years old, dressed up as a missionary, going over the Guatemala-Mexico border and like telling the Border Patrol. I'm like, oh, it's just libros para los niños. Like, don't worry.
Yeah.
You know? And like bringing all these bottles back and like crazy shit. Calling my mom and being like, I just did this crazy thing. I'm in Zipolite, Mexico. And she's like, what the fuck is your problem? Get out of there. I'm like, it's awesome. I'm living on the edge.
Did reality ever, so now again, we're both wiser, older, slightly more tattered and gray. We're a little more aware of our surroundings.
Yes.
Did you have any idea of what might have been political unrest or just general non-safeness in your surroundings at that point?
I did. Yeah. No, I totally did. I mean, you know, when I was living down there, it's not uncommon to get robbed or raped or anything. It's like,
or worse. Yeah.
Or worse. Yeah. It's not. I knew quite a few people that really bad stuff happened to them. I got robbed a few times. Nothing really more than that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I remember distinctly when I went back to Bennington, the first time I went back to Bennington, I had to walk to the art building. It's called VAPA. I had to go to the color. I was a photography major, and I had to go to print some photos in the C lab, the color photo lab. And it was dark, and I'm walking, and it's winter, and I could hear footsteps behind me. Like,
oh, wow.
You know?
Yeah.
And I put my hand in my pocket to grab my keys to, like, and I'm like, I'm a fucking Bennington. Like, what's this guy going to do to me? Like, do you want a croissant or something? You know, like nothing big.
Yeah.
Nothing happens at Bennington, you know, but it was definitely this weird.
But think about like the kind of skills that you acquire. Like,
totally.
Absorbing those other cultures. Like, now you can go anywhere in the world.
Yeah.
You're going to be aware.
Yeah. And I learned a foreign language and like, no. I mean, if I hadn't gone to Bennington, if I hadn't had field work term, if I hadn't started, I mean, I wouldn't have my life.
Yeah.
Currently. You know, that's
those experiences are what kind of defined you, yeah?
Totally. And then I was able to get a job when I graduated, which was huge.
Yeah. Because you're a photography major. And
I was a philosophy and photography.
Philosophy. Well,
which transferred into fine art. I was actually a triple major. I was a Spanish philosophy and photography major, but they wouldn't let me write my philosophy thesis in Spanish.
Why not?
I don't know. I'm like, you guys are fucking assholes.
That's strange. Yeah.
Yeah, so like, we took off the Spanish. So fine art and philosophy was my major.
But a nice, rich kind of just combination of skills and skill sets. And so you're thinking, all right, I've got this degree. What is the ideal opportunity for you as you're leaving college?
So I left college, and just like every liberal arts school student, everyone's like, we're moving to Brooklyn. I'm like, okay. And my twin sister was living there already.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, I'll go. That sounds great. I backpacked across Europe by myself for 3 months, and it was incredibly lonely, but great.
Yeah.
And informative and wonderful. Then I moved to Brooklyn, and I got a job working at Gagosian Gallery, which is like, everyone at my college was so excited.
It's like a dream job, right?
Yeah. They were like, oh my God, you're the greatest. You're working at Gagosian, blah, 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 blah. And I was like very excited. And, you know, I met Larry. He's a prick.
And I was of course, these
asshole.
Guys. Yeah.
Are you listening, Larry?
Was it the one sugar, two sugar thing? Is that the one that I read about? There was a...
Oh, with the coffees?
Yeah.
Literally stuff like that. Like,
what is the point of being like that?
I was a glorified gallerina. It was horrible.
What? Let me ask you, so you're in hospitality. We both deal with lots of people all the time. Why the fuck do people think they can act like that? Where does someone like that come in from to think they can be like that?
Privilege.
Fuck, money.
I mean, God, Blair's got a lot of money. All those people had a lot of money. It was all about because the economy had just collapsed.
Yeah.
And so I was working Gagosian for free or next to free.
Right.
And everyone was still like, this is the greatest. I can't believe you have this job. Like, this is wonderful. So I had to start bartending to actually make money.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've always liked the service industry because I think that I have a personality. I genuinely find self-worth when I make someone else happy.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It just, like, fills me with, like, great, I don't suck, you know?
No,
I made you happy.
It recharges you.
Yeah.
That's why, I mean, the selfish side of this whole thing, getting to meet people like you and talk, it's like, it recharges me. I feel good talking,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Like, no, absolutely. Thing. Me too. But yeah, Gagosian was... It was fascinating. It was a type of art that I used to study.
Yeah.
I met all sorts of famous artists, but it sucked.
It was not what you had expected.
No. It's like, it was an office job, and, you know, I've never had an office job. At that point, I'd traveled all over Latin America. The only other job I'd ever really had was training horses and working in a bar. So I was just like, dude, this shit sucks. I'm like organizing bookshelves and being at the desk in front of the gallery, so when people come in, they're like, hey, and I'm just sitting there, like, blanking out.
God.
It sucked. I hated it. So I quit.
Good.
Yeah, because I was like in the running to be Larry's companion or something. And I'm like, what does companion mean?
Yeah, tell me, what does that mean?
They're like, basically you just travel with him and you're like his, the person that like, you're his assistant. But the only people who were being interviewed were young women. And I was like, this is fucking weird. Yeah. Like, I don't want to do this. So I was like, I'm going to quit. And people are like, this is really bad for your career. You shouldn't quit. And I'm like, I'm pretty sure I'm just going to quit. And around this time, that's when I was delivering some bottles of mezcal around Manhattan for friends of mine, and that's how I got into the cocktail scene, because mezcal is blowing up in New York because the economy had just collapsed.
Is this 2008, 2009?
2008, 2009. Like late 2008, early 2009. The economy had just collapsed, so all of these people who would have normally been in gallery jobs or, you know, writing, like all the creative jobs were the ones that went first.
Of course,
because high end, more like bourgeois shit hit the fan first.
Yeah,
they all went into cocktail bars. So the industry just started to boom, and I was part of that like accidental implosion, you know. And it was fucking cool. It was a really cool time. I hit it just at the right time.
But that's how it is. And I like that you said everybody's telling me that I'm making a massive mistake. This is counterintuitive to my career. Fuck you guys. This was the influential kind of the moment that lent traction to your whole career.
Totally.
About it.
Remember when I told my dad, I'm like, yeah, I'm quitting the gallery and I'm just going to go bartend.
What did he say?
He was like, what? And then he said, he was like, oh, with our last name, someone had to do it. And I'm like, yeah, okay. So, and you know,
yeah, you were born into it with a name like
right,
that.
Right, exactly. Yeah, but you know, people, no one's mom is excited when you're like, mom, I'm going to be a bartender. Everyone's like, oh, shit. And, you know. I mean, I've had more opportunities doing this than I think I ever would have had being some, you know, oh God, like the whole thing is like so snooty, and my mom always tells me that I don't suffer fools gladly.
Yeah.
And that industry is fucking full of them.
I don't like it. I love art. I love film. But you know what's interesting is that in a way, so culture and art is sometimes reclaimed by the masses, right?
Yeah.
It's pulled from the elite.
Yeah.
Hence the French Revolution, perhaps. Yeah. But cocktails are for the people, by the people. You know what I mean?
Like, yeah.
It's just regular people crafting these things, and just you have this innate creativity. Did you find that your sense of color and your sense of symmetry actually served you pretty well in the cocktail piece?
Yeah, I mean, I think that what I realized when I went to college, like I took my philosophy 101 class with this professor, Paul Voice, and I remember going in and being like, oh, I got placed in philosophy 101 because they wouldn't let me into literature or whatever it was.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even called Philosophy 101 because nothing at Bennington's called 101 anything. It's called Philosophical Reasoning, you know? And I was like, okay. And I go,
fine.
Yeah, yep. And I was like, okay, whatever. I'm going to do this shit, but who cares? And it totally blew my mind. I was like, oh, I'm a total geek. And I really like thinking about things. Like yeah. I could say I have all the feels.
Sure.
I just really, like, I love wrapping my head around stuff.
Yeah,
and, like,
yeah.
Trying to understand it and trying to feel it and absorb it. Like, I get, like, high figuring things out. Like I like puzzles.
I love it. Well, so can I ask you a question about that particular proclivity?
Yeah.
We're in a very weird era.
Oh boy.
Right. Of people, right? We feel like we're diametrically opposed to one another in a sense.
Yep. Yeah.
Do you ever think and digest and dissect how we got here where we feel so foreign to one another, even though we're the same thing?
Yeah. I mean, when you're bartending, you get such a wide swath of society. You're just kind of like, there's you, and there's you, and there's you, and there's you. You know, to me, bars are always kind of like churches.
Yeah.
If you have a good one, like hopefully you don't have such a bourgeois bar. You're isolating like 90% of the population. Hopefully you have a bar that people can actually enjoy of all the levels. And I see a lot of stuff and a lot of people and a lot of different variants and degrees. And, like, honestly, I think like working in a bar, you see the best, and alcohol brings out the best and the worst. You're a heightened version of whatever emotion you're feeling.
Yeah.
And sometimes I lose faith in humanity, and sometimes I gain faith in humanity.
So it's a wash. It's an even.
Yeah, but at least I understand it.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just like, oh, okay, this is, like, you're drunk. You're acting like an asshole. I don't think you're an asshole, but get the fuck out of my bar. Like, get out of here. I think a great deal about humanity and who we are and where we are right now. I mean, I don't know how you can't. It's an incredibly disturbing time.
It's like a TV buzzing.
Yeah.
You know?
It's really, but I feel like I get to understand people better than people who don't get to do what I do. You know what I'm saying?
You're absolutely right. You're in the mix.
Yeah.
No pun intended, but you really are.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And
the intersection of all that bustle and the hustle and people exposing themselves.
Yeah.
mentally, you know?
Yeah, and I really like it. I mean, for that reason, I like having a social, you know, I have owned a bar in Brooklyn, so like everyone's relatively the same. It's not like owning a bar in Houston or right. Austin for that matter. Like you don't get that variance of difference in what people think and believe or yeah. are or look like, but it is really interesting.
You know, it's weird, and maybe you've thought about this probably. You followed in your mother's footsteps in that you are doing social work.
Yeah, I guess I am. Yeah, I am.
In a completely different setting and with different vehicles, right. But in a way you are.
Yeah.
You're facilitating conversation, helping people work through things.
Yeah, no, it's true.
It's interesting because for such a long time, people, in such a negative way, they felt bartender, right? So they felt they had to liven the language with a term like mixology. But the reality is now you can make a great living, and for you, this is an amazing career that has given you many opportunities.
Totally. And I did the other stuff too, like, you know, the what else do you do? I bartended for a long time, and I was still applying to grad school. I got into grad school, I think my second or third time trying after I did a few residencies. And when I got in, I actually decided not to go.
Really?
Because my career was starting to take off, and I remember going to, one of the schools I got into was Art Center in California. So I went, and one of my favorite artists teaches there, and I did a tour, and they're about to graduate, and I asked the students, I'm like, so what are you going to do now? And they're like, oh, we're going to move to New York and get a waiting job and get a studio and like try to make it. And I was like,
why?
That's what I'm doing
You've
right now.
You've got plenty of momentum, yeah.
No, I know, but like, that's what I'm doing currently, right now. Not, again, $200,000 in debt. Like, I don't want to do that shit again. So I didn't. I was like, fuck, you know. And I miss it. I miss art so much. But the way
but
that
you never
now,
it is a cruel mistress that way, whether it's music, whether it's writing. Right. Always calls you back, and you find a way
totally
to let it peak and rear its ugly inspirational head.
Exactly.
You know, every now and again.
Yeah, I mean, I go to lots of museums, and I used to for a long time. I got Art Forum, and then I used to read it, and I just got it, and it was like stacking up in my bedroom. I'm like, fuck this. And like, now I'm really busy. Like, I hate when people say they're busy.
Oh, me too.
But I'm not gonna glorify that word because I hate it when people do
that.
Got
a lot going on.
I got a lot going on, and my head's in a lot of different spaces. I've got my toes in a lot of different pools, you know? And I'm happy with that, but like, bring it full circle. The reason why I like booze and cocktails so much is that there's infinite amounts to learn and to know, and that's, I think, the original reason why I got really into it. I'm like, oh, when I first started in cocktails, I knew nothing. I knew about mezcal, but like, and even my mezcal was just all anecdotal. Like, I didn't really know about, I mean, I knew, but I didn't. I was like, people had never been to Oaxaca, and they're like, what? Like, where is this place? I'm like, oh, it's this way down there from, the, you know, right down there. And this, and people were like, how do you know that? And I was like, oh, I guess this is worth something.
Yeah.
And then I got really into, like, why is cognac cognac, and why is whiskey whiskey? And like, and I was like, you know, for like an information buff, I was like, ooh, soak it all in. You know.
Well, you know, it's weird, and mezcal is one of, if not the greatest spirit, but for one main reason, for me at least, and when we talk about Leyenda, this particular chapter, right? So mezcal is art.
Yeah.
So in a sense, these people doing what they feel without the outside influence of Western civilization, ultimately, they just do this thing that kind of passed down. Do you find that behind that bar particularly, that when you're sharing these kinds of things, it's not just serving a drink, it's sharing the art?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think that what we do and what we create as cocktails is art, and you know, not just mezcal. I think that like,
oh, there's
like people who like distillation is, it's a craft, you know, and there's a whole reason why people, it's a craft cocktail, it's a craft spirit or whatever, like, but it's true, like, it really is a craft, and like, the things that people do, it takes a great deal of knowledge and a great deal of skill, and if you do it beautifully, it's a form of art, and I think that that's really fun to share and really fun to work with, and, you know, it's fun, and at the end of the day, when I talk to some of my other friends who, like, do other shit, and I'm like, man, I have so much more fun than you.
Like the colors, the places, the people, the personalities. Again, it's like a very rich profession.
It's very rich, yes. Dense. It's
dense is nice.
It's like HD, I think.
HD?
Yeah.
10K. Yeah. Fucking like really 10K.
Exactly.
Well, there's a few other questions I have for you, and I know that you've got this amazing Texas tour going on. Mm-hmm. We're here at Half Step, drinking the Singani 63, this Bolivian Muscat brandy that is made from great, well, since it's made like cognac, the wine's probably okay, but from the distilled wine. How did you get involved with this project, which brandy, it's we all kind of work in phases. There's that whiskey phase,
Right.
There's that agave phase.
Right.
But eventually, it all comes down to brandy.
Yeah.
So how did you get in?
I got into it. I mean, to me, I mean, it's eau de vie brandy, whatever you can call it, what you will. But I got involved with these guys because I own Leyenda. It's a Latin spirits bar. And whenever there's anything, like whether it be a new tequila or a new rum, or like everyone's always like, hello, knock,
place,
knock,
right?
Knock. Yeah. Are you there? You want to taste it? And I'm like, oh, fuck. no. But yes. So this guy, Jonathan, came in and tasted me on it one day. And I was like, oh, this is really interesting. And to me, it was really interesting because it's Bolivian.
Yeah.
And my menu and the food and the drink, I like to have lots of cultures represented.
Yeah.
I am a real true believer. Leyenda is a bar that celebrates Latin culture. And I'm a true believer that spirits and food have a cultural terroir to them.
Absolutely.
And I really, it's important to me to represent as many Latin cultures as I can on my menu. So when he was like, this is from Bolivia, I was like, no shit, let's try it.
There we go.
You know, I don't have that represented yet because the food from Bolivia is not so great. So I tried it and it was really good. And I was like, oh, it's kind of like Pisco. You know, yeah. It's made from grapes. It's distilled from grapes and comes from South America. It must be like Pisco. And it is kind of like Pisco, I mean, in that way, but it's ridiculous. I mean, the fact it comes from 100% Muscatel grape is so floral. It's like slap you in the face floral.
Just delicious. And it's got so much more vibrance than Pisco to me. Some tea, some fruit, like all these really cool things.
I mean, I really like Pisco as well, but there is something about this that I really enjoy. And, you know, for all the creative people out there, this the person behind this brand is actually Steven Soderbergh.
Oh, yeah. Huge fan.
Yeah, who's not? Yeah, he's amazing. And he discovered it when he was shooting Che, and someone gave it to him, a bottle, his casting director or something. Anyway, when I first tasted it, they're like, Steven Soderbergh's behind it. I'm like, I don't give a fuck about your celebrity. And they're like, who cares? I don't really care. Like, every brand.
Magic Mike, Ivy, come on.
Sex, Lies, and Videotape is my personal favorite. But
well, that's true. We got Traffic. Yeah. We got lots of great stuff. But,
but then they were like, oh, make some cocktails for us for Christmas. And I was like, okay. So I did. And then they're like, oh, Steven's going to come in and shoot them. And I was like, what?
Oh, my God. Really?
Yeah. And I was like, okay. And, I like Singani. And I always have. And I was like, I pour it into my cocktail menu. I like the cultural aspects. I like the way it tastes.
Yeah.
But when I really understood it was talking to Steven about it when he was shooting my drinks, which, you know, sidebar, was fucking awesome. Like, to have Steven Soderbergh taking pictures of your cocktails is like this monumental moment.
Yeah.
I'm like, I've really made it, Mom. take that, Larry Gagosian.
I bet you don't hang out with Steven Soderbergh, son of a bitch.
Exactly. So I'm talking to him, and I was like, so what's up with Singani? Because I really thought that he just like put his name on it, and I was like, you know, whatever. Like, I think it's kind of bullshit, but you're a cool guy, and I like the juice, so what's up? And he was talking to me about the spirit in a vocabulary of not a bartender or a foodie or anything.
Yeah.
He's just a really absurdly intelligent, very creative person.
He's a great painter too, apparently.
Is he?
Did you know that? Yeah.
No, I
didn't. That was, he was going to convert to, after he stopped directing, after Haywire, whatever that Channing Tatum movie was, he's like, I'm going to go to be a painter like I've always wanted to be. Now he came back and did some stuff, like
he's
the candelabra. Amazing dude, right?
He's amazing. And it really inspired me, like, from my whole art background, because I get, like, I miss it. I miss talking to people about art. I miss creative, like, intellectual people.
Yeah.
And he's just a total nerd and came to this stuff in a total nerd way. And I was like, but not in, like, it has tasting notes of blah, blah, blah.
Right.
Or, like, you know, the distillery looks like blah, blah, blah. He just came at it. He just tasted it. I was like, this shit is awesome because I'm a crazy intellectual nut show that is, like, full bursting with the dreams of creativity.
Oh,
and
my God.
I want to represent it. And I was like, and I'm having a very hard time like talking about or just explaining how that situation was for me, but it was really enlightening and such a relief to talk to someone about spirits in a way that wasn't the way we usually, it wasn't in the same vocabulary.
Yeah.
And it really made me have a lot of respect for him and for the spirit and for the whole thing.
That's amazing.
It kind of reminded me of like, so I don't work for Singani, I just do events with them. Like whenever they ask me to do stuff, I'm like, yeah, I'll totally come. And also, they're like, we're launching in Texas. Right after I told them, like, you guys got to launch in Texas. And they were like, oh, we're actually trying to launch in Texas. I'm like, great. When you launch in Texas, I want to go because I fucking love Texas.
That's amazing. Yeah, because you're at Tongue Cut Sparrow yesterday, right?
Yeah.
Half Sip today. What's the next stop?
This is it for now.
Yeah.
I mean, as far as I'm concerned, whenever they want to bring me down here to do stuff, I'm more than excited. I really like it. I really like them. I love Texas. I can't say enough. It's becoming a bit of a problem. I always tell people from Texas, I'm from Vermont, which is actually technically the other Lone Star state.
Oh, nice.
Because we can also secede. Well, actually, that's not true. No longer. But it stopped, I think, sometime in the early 2000s.
Yeah.
But Vermont could also secede from the Union whenever they
really
wanted. Yeah. Texans don't like to hear that very much, but yeah.
Austin will do it maybe eventually. our governor's giving us shit.
Yeah,
he doesn't even like us. We're in the family, and he doesn't like us. Redheaded stepchild all the fucking way. That's what Austin is. So I've got two questions left for you, because I know you got to do some great work here in town. I am so excited to ask you this question, actually. So let's say you are sipping whatever spirit you want to sip anywhere in the world, your favorite bar. If you could sit and have a drink with anybody living or anybody deceased, who would you love to just sit there, sip, and have a conversation with?
I mean, the first person that popped into my head is Susan Sontag.
Really?
Yeah. I think she was just about the most brilliant mind that's ever existed, with one of the most crazy, complicated lives. Like,
yeah.
You know, she was a philosopher, she was an artist, she was all these different things, and she was also like very self-aware, but I think very self-conflicted. You know,
yeah.
She had a son, and then she got into a relationship with the photographer Annie Leibovitz, and like later in life, like came out and like all this crazy stuff. I think she'd be really amazing.
And
I'm actually kind of stoked. That's the first thing that popped in my head. I mean, other ones too, I think I'd pick.
But
one,
I like that though.
Yeah.
You know, because I can tell you just like in the moment, this is who I'm feeling right now.
Yeah.
Because like talking to you, I'm like, man, I'd like to sit down and drink with Cindy Sherman.
Yeah, you know Cindy Sherman.
Yeah.
She's fucking crazy. I wrote my thesis on Cindy Sherman.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah.
I had something intriguing about her, right?
But
this is obviously not about me, although it's for me in just a little bit. But the last question I have for you, I think really right now, we kind of touched on how people are opposed to each other, or at least it feels that way when we're out here. I love everybody. They're very, very nice and down to earth. You've done some great work with Speed Rack in a time where both the rights of women are being infringed upon, the time in which men are demonstrating that they're bigger fuckers than we've ever been. We're the only ones wielding guns and shooting people in public.
Yeah.
Like, do you feel like you've got an influential and an important position in this community to make sure that you're pushing forward for women? And
yeah, you know, I mean, it's such a funny and fucking annoying thing. Like, last night I'm sitting at a bar in Houston, and this guy comes up and he starts like mansplaining me about how there's not enough female talent in Dallas. And I was like, you know, like kind of like head and palms, like, what?
Yeah.
Like, A, like, you don't have to be a woman to have a female presence. That's just number one.
Right.
Like, all it takes is support. So that's that. Like, don't bemoan that there's no powerful women when you could just be empowering somebody.
Yeah.
But yeah, when Lynette and I first started Speed Rack, you know, we did it. And I think I was kind of naive to, I was naive that we had the type of influence. Like, people, I get calls all the time from, you know, women and men, but like, you know, women being like, you know, what about this and what about that and da-dee-da-dee-da. And I think that it's not an easy time to be a woman. I think that it's, people are very conscientious of like, oh, I'm just like a dude. Like, don't separate me. Like, you know, list of like best female bartenders, and like, you know, they're always like, women are always separated for this reason. And I find that to be really annoying. Like, aren't we past that?
Yeah,
you know, but
we're genetically different, isn't that fair?
We're genetically different, but there's no list of the best male bartenders.
Yeah, that's a good point,
because that would be really fucking weird, you know.
Yeah.
But I don't know, I feel like, yeah, I do have a certain role to play, and sometimes it is very touching and moving. Like, just tonight out here, this woman comes up to me and she's like, I just want to let you know that like, you're a big inspiration to me. And like, I can't fucking believe it when someone says that. I'm like, really? Me?
Yeah.
Like, I'm a, like, I don't know, like, makes me feel kind of squirmy, but at the same time I'm like, oh man, like, that really makes me feel great. And I hope that you get to do whatever the fuck you want, because you have the right and you have the power, and that's good. And like, it just takes a little bit of support. And that's the really great thing that Speed Rack has done. More than anything, there's such a support system, and there's like basically a sorority of women who are just, and men, like, there's men and women in it, you know, but it's a tricky thing, because I don't hate excluding people, blah, 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 but I also think that we live in a time where like, people can grab people's pussies and it's like written off as okay.
They can rule the free world.
Yeah. And
fucking crazy.
And it's scary, you know, like, our reproductive rights might be taken away, and it's very, you know, especially since the election, I've been very concerned about white male privilege. And my mom was a huge feminist when we were growing up, and I always thought feminist was like a dirty word. I was like, I'm not a penis hating, like, whatever, mom. Like, I'm never going to be a feminist. And I don't hate dudes by any means. I love dudes. Like, dudes are make the majority of my friends. But I'm very aware right now of the fact that we're being run by a patriarchy, and it's fucking crazy. I just really wish that there's something to be said for having a little female presence, as a female presence, like bringing your female traits to the table in a group setting as a team, because I think there's nothing that exists without other people. We're just all a network, and it's valuable to have that sense of, I mean, there's so many female, like, characteristics of female traits, but I wish that there was more of them, and I have a great deal of fear what's going to happen for women in this country in the next 3 years. But
me too. But intellect will go by the wayside, but it does take people like you and Lynette to say, we're here at least to support you and facilitate a community.
Totally. And that's why I say at all the speed racks, I'm like, you know, if we can lead as an example to the rest of the world of what is possible, like, don't stifle and, you know, molest your women, you know, like, just treat them like a fucking person.
Don't give it a second thought.
Yeah, how hard is that? You know, it's not
just
that
don't
hard.
Don't be a dick.
Yeah, don't be a dick. I'm a person too. That's, you know, right. That's it. So
it's amazing, and I think we're talking about this in an important time, and I hope that we get to share this conversation and people kind of see it for what it is too. It's like, we're not, no one's asking for everything. We're just asking for a little bit of progress.
Yeah.
How fucking difficult is that?
Or just I'm not even sure if progress is the word. I mean, I feel like we're taking steps backwards, but
that's fair.
You know, progress. I feel like progress has been made. Just some knowledge, some realization that, like, you can be a man, you can be a woman, you can be neither of those things.
Yeah.
You can be both of those things, and who gives a shit?
Exactly.
You know, I mean, Descartes, I think, therefore I am. Like, what does this physical thing have to do with any of us anyway?
Right.
Not so much.
At the
anything.
End of it all, right? We're just this notion of electricity.
Yeah, exactly. We're just, like, my mom always says when she always talks about dying is dropping the body.
I love that. That's it. It's perfect.
But it's true. It's like, fucking drop this shit. What difference does this make? It doesn't at all. So
doesn't.
Hopefully people will enlighten to that slowly, but I'm not sure when that will happen.
Well, I really can't thank you enough for sitting down and chatting
thank
with me.
You.
It's great being a half sip. It's great chatting with you, sipping the Singani. I mean, I love Eau de Vie brandies. I mean, this is a really, really lovely tea, fruit, acidity. I mean, it's got all the fucking stuff. You've done a great job.
Thanks.
And I really hope you keep on keeping on.
I'm going to try.
All right. Thanks so much for chatting with me.
Thank you so much. That's awesome.
Well, there we have it. Ivy Mix of New York's Leyenda. A fan of mezcal, a fan of the world, a fan of traveling. And it was just a pleasure to get to experience Ivy in this very transparent way. Many people are very guarded and perhaps unsure of what the world really means to them, how they want to interact with it. But Ivy has this just amazing optimism and just acceptance and embracing all of the things around her. So it was great to chat about movies, art, the whole story, the whole narrative. And also, she's in town representing this amazing Bolivian brandy, Singani 63, tying things back to art with Mr. Steven Soderbergh. So, Ivy, I really appreciate you taking the time out to chat with me, and I hope we can sip some mezcales very soon. And thank you for listening to Show to V with Mike G. No matter if you're waiting for the 200th episode, just like I am, because it's going to be a different format, a different arrangement, or if you're thinking, I'm not sure if I want to see Blade Runner rebooted, are you? Please, keep dancing.